Greetings, Cup supporters. I'm delighted to have back with us Ryan McCann from the Indiana Family Institute, who's going to provide a legislative update on matters dealing with the sanctity of life, the sanctity of marriage, as well as the preservation of natural law, because we are seeing attacks relating to gender identity. You're going to hear from him about things that are going on in our state and even within the school systems around our beautiful Indiana. Ryan, as you may remember, is the executive director of Indiana Family Institute, and IFI is a nonprofit public policy development and advocacy organization focused on strengthening Hoosier families. Ryan himself is a follower of Jesus Christ and is passionate about cultural renewal and God-honoring public policy here in Indiana and nationally. I know that you'll warmly welcome him, and we thank him for his generosity with his time. Enjoy. So, sanctity of life, I want to talk a little bit about that. Biden, as you know, in the last few weeks, he's been a very busy president, signing so many executive orders. He's reversed the Mexico policy, Mexico City policy, and also allowed funding now for Planned Parenthood. Do you think the Indiana Attorney General could sue regarding this issue at all?
Yeah, there are so many issues. I mean, you have so many executive orders. I think President Biden's pen is probably running out of ink at this point because there are so many. And it's kind of ironic because on the campaign trail, he really criticized President Trump for some of his executive orders and said it was undemocratic. And basically that Trump was a tyrant or something because he didn't allow the Congress to work and that he did these executive orders. And then Biden issues many more than any president in our lifetime. So a lot of different organizations are going to have to parse through these and figure out exactly what they'll mean. But I wouldn't be surprised if Todd Rokita got involved. He's already said publicly that he is willing to push back against the Biden administration. I think that will be needed. I think during these 4 years, I think the Indiana legislature and the governor will really need to step up and push back against the federal government quite vigorously in a number of areas. I don't think people realize when President Biden was elected, how far left he would govern. I believe he will govern very far to the left, far more, I think, even in the Obama administration, which was pretty scary to the left. Yeah. And so we're going to see some really troubling things, and it's going to be very important that a lot of elected officials here on the state level are willing to push back, and I'm hopeful that they will.
Well, we saw what happened during President Trump's time in office.
Yeah.
There was so much aggressive pushback, you know, both at the legislative level as well as at the judicial level across our nation, and we have to be willing to do the same thing. The thing that I think conservatives aren't tough enough, we don't have the grit, and we have to have steely resolve on these issues. But it was positive. I saw Todd Rokita, he came and spoke in the freezing cold during the march, the Right to Life march, you know, a couple of weeks ago, that was nice to see him there. So what is the current legislative agenda relating to bills that defend life from conception to natural death?
Well, we're kind of in a weird place here in Indiana and nationally, where you have the U.S. Supreme Court, which has had some really wonderful recent appointments, including Amy Coney Barrett here from Indiana, which is phenomenal. And so I think a lot of people are trying to figure out there are so many pro-life pieces of legislation that are in the pipeline to get up to the U.S. Supreme Court currently. Indiana has had several bills that we have passed that have made it up to the U.S. Supreme Court over the last several years, which has been very interesting and exciting. I think we've helped the cause. And so everybody's sort of trying to feel their way through, okay, how far is the U.S. Supreme Court wanting to go? What kind of state legislation do they want to see to move the ball forward on life? So a lot of states are taking a lot of different approaches. Here in Indiana, we have a few bills. I think really the main bill is going to be, for lack of a better word, sort of an omnibus bill that will have all sorts of different pieces of legislation in it. There's one piece of the bill that says that women have to be informed that they can get a free ultrasound before going through with an abortion. There's regulations on if an abortion clinic fails an inspection, that it needs to be tougher for them to be able to, when they try to reapply for their license with the state, it needs to be a lot tougher for them to be able to get a license back if they are failing inspections in the state of Indiana. A lot of kind of what a lot of people would see as like smaller regulatory things, but that's actually where a lot of the fight has been won over the last several years. When I started at IFI, let's see, 2004 full-time, so it's been 17 years almost now, you had very little regulation on the abortion industry. Now, through so many regulations and just common sense things of, okay, if a hospital has to have hallways a certain width, and they have to have gurneys, and they have to have sterile instruments, so does abortion clinics. Before that time, there was no laws on the books on those kind of things. I mean, it was the Wild West. Yeah. And so we've passed so many regulations that they've had to shut down so many clinics in the state of Indiana because they're not really about women's health. Mm-hmm. They're about the money. And yeah. So what they've done is they've shut down a lot of their centers that were not providing abortions. That's where they make their money. And they've left open the abortion centers and the centers where a lot of abortion referrals came from. And they shut down so many others where they didn't have as many abortions occurring. Yeah. And so, you know, we've seen Indiana at the peak at about 13,000 a year abortions, now to 6,000 or 7,000 a year, depending on the year. Still way too many. Every one is too many. But what we're doing is we're making it much more difficult for them to profit off of the pain and misery of women as they have historically in Indiana and across the country.
Yeah, well, I'm just so encouraged by what you're doing, you know, because I can count on you to defend the sanctity of life. Is there any bill out there that's trying to infringe or attack those rights that you're opposed to?
Sure, there are always a number of bills. Unfortunately, you know, we have Republican supermajorities in the state of Indiana, and so most of those anti-life, pro-abortion legislation does not usually see the light of day. But there are very liberal Democrats in the state legislature. One is a legislator by the name of Sue Arrington up in the Muncie area, who actually used to serve and work with a Planned Parenthood organization. She's a state legislator, and she'll introduce legislation regularly that's very pro-abortion. There's other legislators from everything to making abortifacients, you know, state taxpayers have to pay for those to make sure that they're in forced to be in healthcare coverage, all sorts of different bills that would be supportive of abortion. Because we have a Republican governor and supermajority Republican legislature, even though, you know, just to be a Republican doesn't mean you're conservative, it blocks a lot of that activity that the far left would push in, like California or in New York, for example, where they're legalizing infanticide.
Oh my gosh. I mean, it's terrible. The Born Alive Act that Kamala Harris wants to propose. And by the way, I'm so afraid that is going to make its way down to the states. I mean, and so we're going to see things. Let me shift gears and talk a little bit about the sanctity of family and marriage. So J.D. Ford has a bill out there, Senate Bill 33, that requires all public and private schools to hire an equity, diversity, and inclusion officer. And now I've heard that it's not getting a lot of traction, but now Ms. Herring, she was hired by the governor as the diversity czar. And are you concerned that she could pressure lawmakers? The reason I'm asking this is interestingly enough, Brebeuf just hired a diversity officer. And I don't know if you're aware of this, but they just published all of this material. And in it is a whole cadre of scholarships. And I mean, there's not one scholarship that's for a low income white male at all, right? But the one that jumped out at me was that there is a scholarship for atheists and agnostics in there. And this is supposed to be a Catholic high school.
Right.
Okay. And this is the diversity officer promoting this.
Sure.
So, you know, do you think she has some pressure that this could happen, and what influence can this have in our schools?
Well, I think, you know, we put that on our legislative agenda, and there are several bills that we put on our legislative agenda to basically just educate the public on what the left wants to do. They don't have power in Indiana currently, but they are pushing, and in some cases, some of these ideas are law in other states. One example would be the counseling issue, where if you are a Christian counselor and you have, let's say, a 15-year-old boy that comes in and says, look, I'm having unwanted same-sex attraction. I would like counseling and how to overcome that. And in a number of states like California and New Jersey, it's illegal for a Christian counselor to actually help that student. And so, you know, there are a lot of these kind of ideas. That's actually one that J.D. Ford has championed the last couple of years, that very concept, as well as the one you're talking about with the diversity counselor sort of a person. And the real issue is not diversity. We're all supportive of diversity, right? I mean, America is one of the most diverse nations in the world. And we are very supportive of diversity. What the left means by diversity usually is when they want a diversity officer, that means your organization or your school has to abandon their view of biblical human sexuality. That is what they're trying to get at. And Brebeuf, you know, showed their hand when the issue with the teacher in the same-sex relationship at, I believe, Cathedral or another Catholic high school where they were let go. And Brebeuf did not back up the Catholic doctrine on that. They went the other way. And so you see these diversity officers. We're all for diversity. We want ethnic and racial diversity and in culture. We're seeing that. We're supportive of that. That's not the issue. The issue is, will GLBT activists get to go into Christian schools and push their agenda and make the school abandon what the Bible says about human sexuality?
That's right.
That's the real issue here. J.D. Ford, as your listeners, your Cup supporters may or may not know, is the first openly gay senator in Indiana's history. And so he has been very unapologetic about pushing that agenda from day one. And you see that with the majority of his legislation. I don't see it getting a hearing. I don't see it passing. Okay. I don't see the governor or the diversity officer for the governor having the ability to move that legislation. But it's important for people in Indiana to be aware of this. This is where the left wants us to go. The media won't say it. People won't highlight it. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there will come a time at some point when the pendulum swings back and the left has control of state government here in Indiana. And people need to be aware when and if that time comes, this is the sort of legislation that we're going to have to deal with that could become a reality.
Well, and it's scary because, you know, there's not even a law in the books, and you're seeing the hiring of these diversity, you know, and inclusion officers here at Brebeuf. Right. And it's already the cat's out of the bag. And so it's frightening what's already taking place. And so I'm just so even I'm concerned, you know, could they take it? You talked about gender identity and sexual orientation, right? But what about how they teach about history, right? Could they then impose the theory about critical theory?
Sure. Right.
What, you know, what about the 1619 project?
Sure.
You know,
about,
I mean,
pro-life. I mean,
maybe what about pro-life?
Maybe we need to have more diverse views of life and human conception. You know, we don't need to be so bigoted and single-minded. Right. We need to have a more open and diverse approach on that topic. So I agree. I think it opens Pandora's box. And basically the left is trying to use the term diversity to mean that if you have a different perspective than us, then you are a bigot and you must be stopped. I mean, that's what they do with this, unfortunately.
Well, I know that, you know, your primary focus is on the legislative. Is there any influence that you can have? You know, because I know it's difficult. You're an advocacy. You have an advocacy arm. Is there any influence that you can have to defend against this threat if it starts permeating our schools?
Well, it just depends. When schools just automatically capitulate, like it sounds like Rebuff is doing, it's difficult. In that case, you really need to get to the leadership of the school. You need to get to the funders of the school. You need to get to, you know, those that are making decisions at the school and, you know, encourage them to move a different direction. That's not really a legislative, you know, opportunity. But when you come to public schools, charter schools, even, you know, there's some legislation that would deal with forcing this on private, you know, Catholic schools or other private schools as well. So in that case, it's very important to educate legislators that this is unacceptable, that this is a violation of the First Amendment. The left is very open now with saying that they really don't care anymore about free speech or religious liberty.
No.
What happened to the ACLU? I thought, you know, 20 years ago, they were supposed to be the champion of free speech and religious liberty. And now they're a leading opponent with the far left. And so you're seeing even in Indiana, far left legislators like J.D. Ford and others introducing legislation that throws free speech out the window, that throws free expression of religion out the window. Legislators need to be educated. People need to be educated that this is what the new Democrat Party and the new left wing of the Democrat Party stands for.
This is their platform.
We need to protect the First Amendment.
So are there any bills that are specifically, because we've been talking about gender identity, human identity, and I know that that's a category of yours on your issues, you know, on your page, on your website. Are there any that you believe that are current bills that are on your legislative agenda for 2021 that you have some think have some likelihood of advancing?
Well, you know, there were some positive ones that we were supportive of that we were hoping would get a hearing. I don't think leadership, we'll just have to see if they get a hearing or not. I feel like because of the companies, you know, that we talked about earlier that have, they have really, I think, scared legislators from dealing with a lot of gender identity issues, from a lot of sexual orientation issues, because they're scared to death that the NCAA and the Colts and the Pacers and Lilly and Cummins and all these companies will be breathing down their neck, and Indy Star will have a terrible article on the front page calling them a bunch of bigots. And so they get nervous, and so they don't want to deal with this. I mean, one piece of legislation that was a really good one that I think the majority of Hoosiers would agree with is Senator Cruz's bill that would deal with minors and that medical professionals cannot give minors puberty blocking drugs and cross-sex hormones when they are still minors. A lot of people don't know this, but actually at the Riley Children's Hospital, there is a gender identity wing. And at that, if you go to Riley Children's Hospital's website and you go to the, you can just check out the gender identity wing there. They have a whole page dealing with gender identity. And it's all the language of the left. I mean, it's the talking points of the left. And I mean, in Indiana, people, counselors are sending kids with that have gender identity issues to Riley all the time. And from what I'm hearing, they're getting a steady diet of leftist propaganda over there from the medical folks to parents. And so it is legal in Indiana. If a medical person wants to give a 12-year-old puberty blockers or a 10-year-old so they can't go through puberty, and then start to give them cross-sex hormones, they can do that. What a lot of people don't realize is that will sterilize that child. That child will never be able to have children.
That's
a travesty because of really just flawed left-wing ideology.
And I'm glad you shared that because, you know, IU and a lot of these universities, they do these fundraisers for Riley. And I'm asking CUP supporters right now, you want to act? You do not fund Riley if they're going to have any money that can be directed toward a gender identity of children. We cannot support it. Redirect your funds. Send them over to Indiana Family Institute. Help support their efforts. See the good work that they're doing here. We have to defend our faith, our freedom, our family. All of these things are important. So, okay, so what I want to do is ask you a couple of questions on just unity and collaboration, because that's in our name. And sure. I do believe in that. And so if, you know, one of the things that I've noticed is if, and I feel very strongly, that's why we launched this organization. If we don't use our rights, we lose them. And unfortunately, you know, we have seen Christian leaders, including Catholic, you know, leaders who are not exercising their rights either as vigorously as they should be, or maybe as consistently. And you launched the Daniel Initiative. Which is just wonderful. Why don't you tell us a little bit about this initiative, how many pastors you're working with, and just how it's going?
Sure, absolutely. So the Daniel Initiative was birthed because of our counterpart in Iowa. We have an awesome organization in Iowa, the Family Leader, and there's a guy by the name of Bob Vanderplatz who runs the Iowa organization that's my counterpart there. And they have a great organization there, and for, I think this is their fifth year now, of their pastor outreach program, similar to the Daniel Initiative here. And they have thousands of pastors in Iowa that are participating. They have all 150 members of their legislature has a pastor in their district who meets with them regularly, prays with them, tries to disciple them. You have pastors regularly throughout the session coming and praying with elected officials at the state house. You have situations where you have churches and pastors in certain parts, like in Des Moines, who are actually working in very troubled socioeconomic areas to try to partner with actually a lot of times Democrat local government. And these churches are trying to partner with them to say, hey, there's some problems. There's some crime problems. There's problems with the schools. There's problems with abandoned buildings. How can we as churches and the faith community come together with you and solve some problems that may not be ideological left versus right, but are just common sense ways to heal the community? Yeah. And so we thought that was just a brilliant idea, and they have done very, very well with that in Iowa and have just done some tremendous things. So back in midway through 2019, Iowa allowed us to participate and create our own program. Josh Hirschberger runs that for us here in Indiana. Josh has been in contact with a ton of pastors in the central Indiana area, other pastors, priests, or anyone in the Christian community who is a faith leader that would like to be connected with Josh. We'd love to have you do that. Go to our website, and we have a Daniel Initiative page there. We'd love to connect with you. Josh is connected with just tons of pastors in the central Indiana area, has connected with them, with their legislator, has brought them down to the state house to just kind of see, hey, look, these are regular people like you and I. The Bible tells us that we need to be offering prayers for those in authority, and that we need to pray for them and help them to be effective so that we can all live in a community that we want to live in. And
amen.
Connect those pastors with those elected officials, pray for them, disciple them, and also, when it's appropriate, help them to understand some of the issues back home in their communities that are a problem that maybe that church or that parish could help with. Maybe they have a focus on helping people with opioid addiction or drug abuse.
Absolutely.
They have some help of homeless and how to get homeless some of the care that they need. A lot of other issues, foster care issues or other things. There are churches that I found and other faith leaders across the state who are good Christian organizations who are doing great work. Very few people know they exist or what they do. And these elected officials are making public policy, having no idea that they have the answer and the key right in, back in their district, of a great group that knows the answer, that knows how to address these issues. And so when these elected officials are making public policy on some of these topics, it's really helpful to have the local church to be infused in that. For far too long, we've bought into this idea of separation of church and state, not only within government, but within the church, where the church is scared to death to disciple their elected officials.
Amen. What is going on? I'm telling you what's going on. Yeah. You know, this is why we formed CUP, because for some reason they don't think they have the ability to get up there and speak their mind.
Right.
And but we need them to. We need them to, because we're listening to them. They're our leaders. We're their flock.
Right.
And we follow them. And so it's so important. So and what you're doing is so important, because see that there, what I see is it's two prong. You know, you're dealing with the legislators, but you're also trying to branch out and deal with all of the faith leaders within the community. And it's going to lead to my next question, because we have to work collaboratively. We must work and be connected, and everything must be connected to God, right? Because he informs us on everything that we do, because if we don't start from there, we're lost.
Right.
So I'm so glad that you've done that. You know, there's so many organizations that support conservative causes and frankly have overlapping objectives. How much collaboration and exchange of ideas are you seeing happening, perhaps now with the Daniel Initiative, that have different sets of core supporters? I mean, because there's probably people of Protestant faith, evangelical, Catholic, may even be, I don't know, Muslim, maybe not, but if you could share, you know, what cross collaboration there is, and then the melding of those ideas.
All right. Well, Indiana Family Institute, really at the heart of our culture and our DNA from the very beginning, has been very collaborative. You know, even our subtitle of our mission there is uniting communities to strengthen families. And so we've always been that kind of organization. Matter of fact, way back in the day, way before my time, there were actually two pro-life kind of advocacy organizations here in Indiana, more of an evangelical Protestant one and a Catholic one. And actually IFI, years before I was here, kind of helped broker that relationship that helped to meld those two organizations, which ended up forming Indiana Right to Life, who is a great partner of ours and someone we work closely with still to this day. So we've always had that kind of collaboration. When we are in the legislature and we're advocating for certain policies, it helps to have people from all over the spectrum. And so I've had on pro-life issues or traditional marriage issues, I've had Orthodox Jewish rabbis to testify on their issues. I've had Catholic priests. I've had Protestant pastors. We've had all sorts of people across the spectrum. As a matter of fact, after RFRA, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, I had a gentleman, a Muslim gentleman, reach out to me and say, hey, look, I'm of the Muslim faith. I understand that's different a little bit from where you all are coming from, but I'm having some issues with my employer dealing with my religious liberty. And I know you're passionate about religious liberty. And so we had some collaboration even there. There's obviously a very small Muslim population here in Indiana. So that's a bit limited. But in one specific case, there was an opportunity to work a little there. And he understood, hey, I agree with your perspective on religious liberty. It's so important in America. Someone that I might not agree with on a lot of other issues, but we can work together on that. And so that's really the heart of our organization, always has been, always will be. And so we love to partner with all sorts of different folks on common goals: life, marriage, religious liberty, family, the things that CUP cares about. We want to work with a broad group of folks, because we know that maybe someone from a different community or different background or different, a little bit different belief than I would have, that just enriches the effort when particularly the hands and feet of Christ, when we have different gifts and abilities, they can all come together. That's when you really get some powerful things. And so that's really the heart of who we are.
Yeah, beautifully said. Just beautifully said, Ryan. I commend you for that. So the public and even religious high schools and college educational institutions are churning out graduates, you know, with liberal pedigrees. Is there a game plan by conservatives to take back control of the education of young minds in this country?
Yeah, it really is amazing when you look at universities. Even here in Indiana, we give $100 million every two-year budget cycle to Indiana University and other public universities. And my question is always, you know, what are we getting from that? And where are the checks and balances? And, you know, there are a lot of negative things happening on even on college campuses here in Indiana that are publicly funded by our tax dollars. And yet there is a steady stream of left-wing propaganda and anti-Christian propaganda on these universities. I've debated professors from, particularly from IU, on numerous occasions on the marriage amendment and other things. And they are hardcore left-wing activists over there. And we are just sending them floods of money constantly. IU, for example, I believe has a $3.5 billion endowment. They get, you know, tons of money from Adidas and contracts and others for sports and other things. And yet taxpayers are sending them, you know, tons of money every budget cycle. And so, you know, we do want to push back on that. We have one piece of legislation this session that would, it's not huge, but it would at least take a small step of holding public universities accountable for when they violate the free speech rights and religious liberty rights of students and professors. And if you're a student on a public university campus, you should not be a second-class citizen just because you have a Christian faith, just because you have a conservative view of life. And so, unfortunately, we've seen that time and time again, particularly at IU, but at other universities across our state, where there is discrimination that happens against conservatives and against Christian students. And we want to see some accountability. So we have a piece of legislation in the House that Jack Jordan is authoring that would bring some accountability to public universities so that they don't violate particularly the free speech rights of students in their care.
Well, that's good. Good for Jordan, and I'm glad to see that you're advocating for that. So we talked about the executive orders. It's insane what's going on with Biden right now.
It is.
I don't know. Can the Attorney General do anything to protect Indiana from all these? You know, you look at California when Trump was in, and they developed all these sanctuary cities, right? These concepts, these sanctuary cities. States should have the right to protect them, their own citizens, right?
Right.
I mean, we should have that right. And, right. And make sure that our own constitution is being followed. So what can we do? What can we do about this?
Well, I found it very interesting towards the last half of President Trump's administration. The far left discovered the 10th Amendment to the Constitution. For all these many decades, they have ignored the 10th Amendment, which says that all rights not given to the federal government within the U.S. Constitution stay with the states. But yet that has been ignored over and over again by federal courts and Congress and liberal states, really, for many, many years. And all of a sudden it was discovered. I welcome that. I encourage that. I do think the 10th Amendment is still there and still should be used. I think that state and local officials in Indiana, when there are things that come from the federal government that obviously violate the Constitution of the United States or violate our state constitution, that those need to be pushed back on very energetically. And Todd Rokita's history in Congress and Secretary of State, he has been a solid conservative all the way through. I hope he will continue with that. Like I said, his early communication, the things that he's saying from his office, I think he'll fight those. We'll see how much Governor Holcomb will want to fight those. I hope he will. I hope the legislature will want to fight those. And even at the local level, I hope folks will want to fight those. I think it depends on the executive order. There's so many flying around. You know, the sanctuary cities was largely on the immigration issue. So we'll have to let the dust settle and figure out exactly the impact of these executive orders one by one and the details of what those entail. But I do believe there's going to be many opportunities for state and local officials to push back. And just because the President of the United States gives an executive order, that doesn't mean that the U.S. Constitution no longer exists.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well said. And, you know, I do think that we're going to have to learn from the liberals. We have to take a page out of their book. We learned what they did. And, you know, I'm sad to say it was effective. And so we have to get tough. Well, Ryan, I am so delighted that you shared so generously so much time with us today. I just want to thank you, and I'm going to pray for many blessings for you and your family, especially your newborn little one and your wife, Tori, and especially IFI. And folks, CUP, the Indiana folks, go to their website, check out the 2021 legislative tracker there that they're going to be posting. And just look at their website. And, you know, if you feel called to, please make a donation. They need these funds. They're a 501c3, just like we filed for a 501c3. We're not tax exempt yet. I encourage you to donate to them because they need the funds to sustain all of these good works that they're doing that completely align with the mission of CUP. I always like to part with a prayer. So do you mind if I do that?
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Vicki. I appreciate it.
So we're Catholics. So we're going to start with the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your many blessings. And I ask you to pour down your grace and your blessings upon Ryan McCann and upon the Indiana Family Institute and all of its efforts. And I ask you to defend our family, our faith, and our freedom in this state and in our country this year and in all the years beyond. We ask all of these things in your good and precious name, in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you so much, Vicki. I appreciate it. And you'll be in my prayers and CUP will be as well. I thank you so much for the good work you're doing. And it's just a pleasure to be able to partner with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day.